Hi, I'm Debbie Levine. I'm the Senior Deputy Editor of Radiology, and I'm here today doing a podcast on a topic that we have not done before, and that is testicular microlithiasis. We have Dr. Andrew Trout on the video with us. He is an assistant professor at the University of Cincinnati, and he's chief of nuclear medicine at the Children's Hospital in Cincinnati. And he led a retrospective study from six different pediatric sites, his own Children's Hospital, as well as Children's Hospital in Boston, Children's Hospital Philadelphia, Hospital for Sick Children in Toronto, the C.S. Mott Children's Hospital in Michigan, and Texas Children's Hospital. And together they wrote an interesting article for our November issue regarding the association between testicular microlithiasis and testicular neoplasia in a pediatric population. So with that introduction, Dr. Trout, welcome.
Thank you.
Can you tell us a little bit about what you did and what you found?
So essentially, as you said, this was a retrospective study where we tried to leverage the large patient populations at the multiple children's hospitals that we had in our research group with the question of exploring the association between microlithiasis and testicular tumor, because we'd seen a couple of articles come out that have sort of come out on both sides of the equation in terms of there being a relationship or there not being a relationship between the two. So the idea was to pull all these groups together, get some bigger data, and see if we could get a better answer to this question, or at least get some more data to sort of further the argument one way or another. But essentially what we did is we went back and looked at all testicular ultrasounds that had been performed at the various institutions and looked for reports that flagged the presence of calcifications or microlithiasis. We did not look back at cases that did not specifically flag the presence of those based on the initial read, but cases that did identify microlithiasis all were reviewed by the local site PIs to make sure that there truly was microlithiasis present, that it adhered to the definition of more than five calcifications in a single image, punctate calcifications, not coarse, et cetera. But, and then we looked at the frequency of tumors among those various groups, both the patients with microlithiasis, tumors that were dissected by ultrasound, and also pulled tumor data from the pathology data banks at the various institutions to get a real sense of the volume of testicular tumor. Then simply looked at the frequency of tumor in each of the groups, the boys with microlithiasis and the boys without, to see if we could calculate odds ratios for the frequency of tumor in the two groups.
Great. And then what did you find for your odds ratios?
So what we found is that there was about a 4 to 5% rate of tumor in boys with microlithiasis, and far less than a 1%, actually a 0.3% rate of tumor in boys without microlithiasis. And so the odds ratio becomes quite significant. It was in the range of 15 to 20, depending on how you adjust it in the various different tumor types. So we looked at all neoplasia, but then also focused down at various different subtypes, such as germ cell tumors, and stromal cell tumors, and found that there were associations, each of them strongest with germ cell tumors.
Great. And, you know, one of the issues that you as an author and I as a deputy editor went back and forth with a lot about this paper is that the tumors were present in the patients with microlithiasis. But that doesn't necessarily mean that if you found someone with microlithiasis and then followed that patient over time, that that patient has an increased risk, because what you've done is retrospective and you found this association, but not necessarily causality. And I'm wondering if you can comment about that, because I think it's a really important take-home message from your paper and one of the limitations of a retrospective study.
Right. So that is certainly the case. And then exactly what you're pointing out is true in the sense that we are unfortunately tied to data that currently exists. We don't have big cohorts of boys with or without microlithiasis that have been serially followed over time to see how frequently or if they develop tumors. That would look at more of a potentially a causal effect there. All we're able to say is that when we look at these two groups, boys with microlithiasis and boys without, tumors seem to be more common in the boys with microlithiasis. So like you're saying, it's really an association. We can't prove that it was the microlithiasis that led to the tumor in these boys. And so that is an important distinction. And unfortunately, it's going to be difficult to get to that causal argument, because you saw this was a study of, you know, 37,000 boys, and the frequency of tumor is still quite small in that population. So to really get at that causal relationship, you'd have to follow tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of boys over many, many years. You know, we know these processes take, you know, years to develop to really get a sense of where things lie. So again, there's a lot to be learned here in terms of what the causation is, but there certainly does seem to be a relationship there.
And one of the strengths of your study, having brought out one of the weaknesses, but one of the strengths was that you did have six sites. They were all in North America, but they were from very geographic areas. And they had a lot of variability between those sites. And I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about the site-specific variability.
Right. So that's one of the powerful things about this study. Not only do we have these multiple large sites that allow us to bring together large numbers of patients, both with and without microlithiasis, but it begins to get at some of those regional and potentially geographic differences, and maybe even some other things that we don't understand there. I mean, we see that in the frequency of microlithiasis, with higher rates of microlithiasis at some sites other than versus others, which suggests that maybe there are environmental factors that are at play in terms of the development of microlithiasis, and also the pretty striking differences in the frequency of tumor at the various different sites. We had one site that had no patients with microlithiasis that had tumor, and other sites that clearly had cases of patients with microlithiasis and tumor. And so I think that to some degree explains the findings that have previously been in literature, where you've had large single center studies that have had thousands of patients, and yet they get very dramatically different results. And we see that even among our own data, but when we put it all together, there does still appear to be an association. And so I think that's the power of these large multi-center collaborations.
So you had the different sites look at their own data. And so one of the other variables that could be present besides the real environmental factors are actually the way scans are being performed and the way they're being interpreted. Because we know with ultrasound, you can change some buttons and make your images a little bit blurrier or a little bit less contrasty. And we know that some people tend to call more, things that are bright than other people. So they set their threshold differently. So can you comment on environment factors and maybe performance and interpretation factors as affecting your results?
Right, and that's certainly the case. The other thing that was at play here is we looked at patients for, you know, more than 10 years back, right? And so you're also introducing changes in technology over time, which have effect on the visibility of various different features in ultrasound. So that certainly is something that's going on here, and it's difficult to control. As I said, we looked at, for the patients without microlithiasis, we looked at reports. So it is possible that there are patients that were in there that didn't meet the original reader's threshold for microlithiasis, and that may have been missed, potentially underestimating the number of patients. And as you said, the differences there certainly complicate this question. And if we're really going to be doing this, or if we're really going to establish a relationship or try to establish a relationship going forward, that's where it becomes critically important to all come to some agreement, certainly on the definition of microlithiasis and understanding what truly constitutes microlithiasis to make that call. So we're all making it an equal call. It's vendor differences are going to be a little more difficult to overcome in this context, but it certainly could be contributing to what we're seeing.
Right. So, you know, here's a tough question in case you think I haven't asked you any tough questions yet. So a patient comes in, a young child, maybe 6 or 7 years old, and you see testicular microlithiasis and you don't see any tumor. Does that mean that this patient then needs to be followed yearly for the rest of his life with ultrasound?
I think that's a question that I'm not confident we can answer based on the data we have. Like was pointed out earlier, we've shown that there is some relationship here between microlithiasis and tumor. It's not yet clear what else is at play here in terms of other factors that are weighing in on that. And I think it still remains to be seen what the time course is for development of tumor if it truly does relate back to microlithiasis. So I think that's still quite a difficult question to ask, and I think will be subject to quite a bit of debate. And even if we do prove that, yes, the microlithiasis is predisposing or causing the development of tumors, I think it still remains to be determined what the best follow-up strategy is, or screening strategy would be for the population. Is it physical exam serially over time? Is it ultrasound? Is it physician exam? And I think all of that remains to be teased out. And as we've said several times, is going to be complicated to do because of the relative infrequency of the disease. So it's begging for a large study. It's something we'd like to do, trying to find support for. Would likely, again, have to be a multi-center, potentially NIH sort of driven study to really get at this question and get all the stakeholders involved, the urologists, the patients, the radiologists, all these sorts of people. And as you pointed out, get some agreed upon standards in terms of imaging technique, interpretive criteria, et cetera. So it's complicated. I think it's, again, though, to circle back to your question, I think it's difficult to make a concrete recommendation at this point. I do, though, think we need to be aware that there appears to be some relationship here.
So if you were doing a study today and saw a boy with microlithiasis, what would your recommendation for follow-up be?
I tend to limit my recommendations in terms of calling out specific recommendations in my reports, and I tend to engage more in dialogue or in discussion or have at least understanding in advance with my various clinical colleagues in terms of how we're going to, as a group, work up and follow up these patients. So I think more important than coming down with a hard recommendation based on some finding on an ultrasound is having an understanding in your institution based on your understanding of the data in your local population, how you're going to treat and follow these patients over time. So I'm, to some degree, I'm evading your question, I'm doing so in a calculated way, in the sense that I think we have to be careful making recommendations like that, because they do have very real implications in terms of cost and other effects going forward.
And then one kind of basic question, you did this in children, and there have been a lot of studies in adults. Is there any reason to think that testicular microlithiasis in children is different than the microlithiasis that we see in adults?
So I don't think we know the answer to that. Even those studies that have been done in adults, it's not clear when the microlithiasis developed in those individuals. And so as we're trying to figure out the relationship here, you know, if there is a relationship between microlithiasis and tumor, does it have anything to do with the timing of the onset and essentially the duration that you've been sitting there with microlithiasis? And if so, is it actually riskier to have seen it in a child? Is that more meaningful? So I don't know that we know. We do know that it seems to take time to develop tumors. That's one other limitation of our study, which is that we did cut our age range at 18 years. And anecdotally, there were a couple of patients in our cohort who went on to develop tumors as they aged out of our cohort. So these things take time, and they take time to manifest. So I don't know that we know yet whether the pediatric population is different from the adult population.
And this wasn't quite part of your study, but again, I think it's an interesting question to ask. Since you're a referral site, If you were referred someone with a diagnosis of microlithiasis and you scanned them and didn't feel that microlithiasis is present, would you then be able to, you know, reassure parents and say, oh no, your kid's normal, no further follow-up is needed?
So I think that to some degree circles back to your question previously about technique. I think that, you know, anytime we are a referral center, and so anytime we're getting a patient from somewhere else with a diagnosis, ideally, we can review the exam that was performed at the outside, number one, to see why they might be making that call. But then secondly, as long as, you know, our technique was optimized, and I feel like ours is, and to the point that I felt like I could confidently include or exclude the presence of microlithiasis, I think it is okay to reassure families. We do that, you know, with patients sometimes that come with a diagnosis of appendicitis from somewhere else, and their imaging here may not show that, or even review of an outside image. So I think that is appropriate, and does bring the value of subspecialty expertise. But again, it gets back to, you know, having a standardized technique and standardized interpretive criteria, so you're truly confident you can be sure that you're excluding correctly.
Terrific. So we've talked a lot about microlithiasis. I'm wondering, what kind of research is your group working on now? Are you going to continue this multi-center type of approach to other questions?
So, you know, we were really happy with how this turned out. We found a great group of collaborators. It was really effective in terms of being able to bring a lot of data together. So this has sort of invigorated us to continue this. So we are very interested in continuing these multi-center studies. We've been meeting recently with some of our colleagues from other institutions during a course that we recently held here. So this is certainly something we want to continue. I think, you know, it does require effort, and you want to make sure that the effort is going to be valuable and targeted, but it can be a really powerful thing to sort of break out of our institutional silos and get out there and work with our colleagues.
Terrific. Well, thank you so much for taking the time to talk with me today. I'm sure our listeners will appreciate hearing about all of this and really help put your paper into perspective for their own care when they're screening patients and have this finding. So thank you very much.
Thanks for having me.